do 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 do. Welcome to the podcast.
Wee.
We'll get this started. You're like reading an old Entertainment Weekly. Does any of that really matter now?
I'm not reading it. I just that video, that clip is so funny. Single Ladies with Justin Timberlake and Andy.
I don't think I've seen that.
Oh my gosh. We gotta look it up and watch it. Well, it's so fucking funny.
With that, welcome back to Sequel Podcast. I'm Ed Bonta.
And I'm Kelly Stoll.
And we're trying to get my mom up here on the Skype machine, as they call it. Single Ladies by Beyonce.
Put SNL Single Ladies.
Alright, here we go. This will probably
Charter TV gives
from
me
YouTube.
Crystal clear picture.
This video, so you won't be able to watch it on mobile, maybe. because we're gonna listen to it on the podcast. Alright, so we're watching Single Ladies.
It's like crap, hold on. It's Justin Timberlake and Andy Samberg.
Was that Beyonce?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's all fucking blurry.
Oh my gosh.
They're wearing fucking heels and shit.
Have you seen the actual Single
Nah.
Ladies? Okay.
Is it just like
this? It's just like this, yeah. Just like that.
Twerking up on her. Dude, he is all fucking up on her. Oh, and that's what the fuck's his name? What's that dude's name? Bobby Moynihan?
Moynihan, yeah.
He's good.
He's still on SNL. He's pretty funny.
Yeah. A lot of the better ones have left, but I like him.
Yeah, Jason Sudeikis isn't on there anymore.
Oh, he's not on there anymore?
No. Bill Hader isn't on there anymore.
Yeah, I remember Bill Hader leaving.
Fred Armisen isn't on there anymore. Andy Samberg's not on there anymore.
No, Andy Samberg left a little while ago. Same with Kristen Wiig, too.
Yep. Yeah, everybody's basically new. Bobby Moynihan's still on it, and Kenan Thompson's still on it. He's pretty funny, too.
Kenan Thompson and Seth Meyers have been on there since, like, 2003.
I don't like Seth Meyers.
He's the longest-running SNL member.
Well, yeah, because he does the... But he only does the...
The writing. He only does the...
No, he only does the...
Because he's the
Weekend Update, yeah.
All right, let me see that.
No, I'm not still looking at it.
Well, go to the 50. Me and Kelly are going to cover the top 50 sexiest movies of all time.
Okay.
So let's start. Does it start at 1 or does it start at 50?
Started at 1. You think they'd start backwards, right?
You would think that.
That's weird. 40. I want all the shit in between it.
That's got some.
Okay.
All right, we'll start at 50. What is 50, Kelly?
300.
The 50th sexiest movie of all time. You don't like watching
a bunch of dudes
run
around?
Okay,
well, okay. Yeah, that's the only good part, is seeing them all naked.
I mean, sure, it's not a
Gerard
sexy
Butler
movie.
Naked.
It's an action movie.
Yeah.
Okay. See, now you're getting into the podcast.
Hey, we can talk about sexy movies. This will get... I can get into this.
Okay, so you're fine with 300 being this number 50?
So it's sexiest movies ever. Okay.
So not like...
Not like romance. It's
not
sexiest movies ever.
Yes.
Okay.
So you're all about the
Okay,
oily,
I could see
dudes.
That because of all the naked dudes in it.
Right.
Okay. I can see it.
Okay, what's 49?
Do you like 300? Do you like seeing naked men?
I don't like seeing naked men, but I can watch that movie because I'm comfortable with my own sexuality.
Okay.
So you can go fuck
okay.
yourself, Kelly.
Sorry. Yossi and Jagger's 49. I don't know what the fuck that movie
is. What
is it? You know, 2003?
Yeah, I don't know.
It's an Italian movie, it says.
Next one.
How Stella Got Her Groove Back.
Didn't see it. Did you see it?
Nope. That's right. The... What movie? That's the...
That's the first one to that movie that just came out, right?
It's a... Who's in it? Whoopi Goldberg,
Tay
right?
Tay Diggs? I don't think Whoopi's in it.
Tay Diggs, yeah. Seduces years older Stella. Oh. No, I've never seen it.
Alright, next one, then. We'll skip to
there's a
to
picture
the
of it. Okay.
47,
Kissing Jessica Stein.
Didn't see it.
Nope, never seen it.
Okay, we don't know shit about movies, apparently.
46, Like Water for Chocolate.
Didn't see it.
Nope. This is why they're low, because nobody fucking knows what they are. 45, The Bridges of Madison County.
I want to see that, but I've never seen it.
I've, nope.
That's Clint Eastwood and Meryl Streep.
And then it says, The Highs and Lows of Christian Bale's Sexiest Role was American Psycho.
Do you agree?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah, he looks great in that movie, even though he's a fucking crazy-ass person.
He's an American Psycho.
And then least sexy role, The Machinist, when he was, like, fucking
emaciated,
skinny and creepy. Yeah.
Emaciated like none other. Bleah. Are there only two on there? What's in between? Batman?
Oh, no, it just has, like, a little...
High and low.
It's just high and low,
oh,
yeah.
Okay, all right.
And then 44, King Kong, 1933.
I mean, that's kind of sexy, because, like, he's...
You know, I've actually...
undressing...
I've seen it once. You let me borrow it once, but I don't remember a whole lot.
Well, I think they're referring to, like, what does the blurb say there?
You may wonder what's so alluring about a giant ape dragging around the love of his life like a screaming Barbie. But Kong, a big lug possessed by Lamar Few, is that what it says? Is a doomed as Romeo. Sexiest moment in a once-censored scene, Kong fondles Faye Ray's Anne, strips off a piece of her clothing and sniffs it. Then, like a kid, he tickles her.
Yeah, yeah.
Huh.
That's what I assumed it was.
I guess it's just maybe I'm not. It's not bringing it to mind because I'm. I guess back in the day, like that would be considered like.
Sure, definitely. 19.
You know, racy.
33. You know? Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, I could see that. 42 Little Children.
Well, you skipped 44, right?
That was 44.
King What's Cog. This one?
43. Oh, 43. I did skip 43. Dirty Dancing.
Dirty Dancing. I mean, sure. You've seen Dirty Dancing.
That's weird. I'm surprised it's rated this low, because I would think it'd be up higher, but I haven't seen the rest of them yet.
Yes,
so
we haven't gotten to the list.
So I don't know. We'll see.
The Dirty Dancing.
I love that scene. This reminds me of that scene in How I Met Your Mother where they put Neil Patrick Harris's face on it. Oh my gosh, I was laughing my ass off.
They didn't put his face on there, they just put him in the scene,
no,
right?
It's his face only.
I thought it was his whole body.
Mm-mm. They put, like, his head.
Okay.
But they did a good... Oh, God, that part was so funny.
Well, I mean, it's obviously sexy because it's, like, a younger girl, and she's in love with this older guy.
Okay, so sexiest moment in Dirty Dancing, baby drops in on a shirtless Johnny in the middle of the night and confesses her love to him.
Did they have sex in that scene?
They do.
Did they have sex in that movie?
They do.
Okay.
Yep. So like 42 is Little Children.
Right.
Sexiest moment, Brad leers at Sarah in her bed and her red bathing suit and her flirtatious touch. Steamrolls talk about the weather. Hot enough for you?
Oh, is that
maybe it was a sad movie. Yeah.
It is a sad movie. It's
that's what
movie.
This one is.
Right there.
Yeah. You see Kate Winslet butt naked in that movie a couple times. And
well,
him.
Because they're like banging in the attic, I think.
Yeah.
Or
no, it's like
room?
It's like a laundry room. It's a fucked up movie. 41, The Bodyguard, Kevin Costner.
You know what? I watched that for the first time.
Did you?
A couple years ago when I was in Denver.
Whitney Houston.
And I was not the biggest fan. I thought it was kind
of
bad.
Yeah, yeah. Sexiest moment, Costner carries Houston out of a club gig turned riot as she throws her arms around her new caveman protector.
It's raining out.
Yeah, I mean... Yeah, I thought it was okay. It wasn't, like, a great movie.
No, it was not a great movie in any way. And she looks so fucked up in that movie, too.
Well, yeah, well, she's fucking on drugs the entire
time.
Yeah,
and she's obviously dead now.
Right.
Two Tsunami.
40, The Last Seduction.
I wanted to see that.
I don't know. I've never heard of it.
Linda Fiorentino. Mm-mm. It's supposed to be a pretty good, like, crime thriller of sorts.
Hmm. All right, so 39 is The Talented Mr. Ripley, which I still haven't seen yet.
It's on your list.
So one scene wonder. Sometimes all you need is a few minutes or even seconds of sex. On screen, of course. Below are six films that prove short can definitely be sweet. So we got Cool Hand Luke, 1967.
Yep.
Witness, 1985.
Have you seen Witness?
That? No, I
Harrison
haven't.
Harrison Ford? He won an Oscar for that movie.
Oh, shit, no. I haven't seen it. No Way Out.
Didn't
Kevin
see that
Costner. When Harry Met Sally, the scene where she's orgasming.
I haven't seen that movie.
Okay, Matt, you have to see it. Especially if you're in this... No, I don't. Especially if you're in this romance kick right now. You gotta see that movie.
I know it's one... I mean, it's not like it's not on my list of movies.
Yeah, no, I mean, if it's... But you're like, because of what you have been watching lately, that's definitely something you need you need to see.
How long ago do you think I was watching these romance movies? It's been a while.
You've been watching them for the last couple of weeks.
Have I? What have I been watching?
You watched Titanic, and you watched... What other Leo movie did you watch?
The Departed?
No, there was some other... There was something else.
I watched Gangs of New York recently.
No, there's something else. Some other sad movie you were torturing yourself with. Well, now you're going to watch Romeo and Juliet.
Great Gatsby, but I didn't watch Gatsby since I bought it.
Oh, actually, that's a good movie.
That is. This is a good one, too.
Say Anything. Mm-hmm.
All right.
When Harry Met Sally, look it up on Amazon. I'm pretty sure Amazon has it.
Yeah, but I'm broke at the moment. All right, so that's four, right?
But you've seen clips of that scene, right?
I know the scene,
definitely. And then Thelma and Louise, that's the first movie you ever see Brad Pitt in, which was supposed to be given to Johnny Depp, and Johnny Depp turned it down, so Brad Pitt took the role.
I haven't seen that movie. It is a Ridley Scott movie, and I love Ridley Scott.
He is sexy. That's the first movie he was ever in, and he's fucking shirtless.
Now look at this. The Blu-ray is only $5. Maybe I have some money on my Amazon account. I doubt it, though.
Yeah, I wish I had. That's the movie I need to get. It is. It's a very good one. And then Atonement. That scene where they're in the library.
Absolutely. That was a weird scene. I remember watching that, not quite... I mean, I understood what was going on, but it was just a little weird.
I see what you're saying. Okay, so number 38 is the Secretary.
Didn't see that one either. I know that that's one of those very sexy movies.
Maggie Gyllenhaal and James Spader.
Yeah.
I've actually never even heard of it. In the Mood for Love, 2000.
Haven't seen it.
Nope. Ghost, obviously. It's 36.
I haven't seen Ghost.
You haven't seen Ghost?
I haven't seen Ghost.
That's another one you need to
see. I think that's actually on. That might even be in my queue.
I think it's on Netflix.
Yeah, I think it's in my queue.
That's a good one. It's sad, but it's good.
Well, let me ask you this real quick about Ghost. How good is your memory on Ghost?
It's pretty good.
So, he channels through Whoopi Goldberg, right?
Yeah.
But then don't they have, sex? When he's after he's dead, him and her. So would it be she's having sex with Whoopi Goldberg?
No, they don't. They don't.
They don't. Mm-mm. They just talk.
No, they have sex before he dies.
Right. They're doing the whole.
And I think he tries to kiss her or something when he's in with Whoopi Goldberg, but it's nothing like.
Okay.
Yeah, it's.
Not... I haven't seen it, so I'm
no,
just
no, it's
going
not
off
sex
of...
or anything.
Okay.
34, The Unbearable Lightness of Being.
Nope, haven't seen it.
Daniel Day-Lewis. 33, She's Gotta Have It, Spike Lee's feature film.
Haven't seen that one either. All these movies we haven't even seen.
Mm. Cruel Intentions, 32.
That's a very sexy movie.
Sexiest Moment, when Geller coaxes doe-eyed Cecile to kiss her.
Of course.
Of course, that's the part they think of. One of
Sarah
Michelle Gellar and
was,
Reese Witherspoon kissing.
That was a huge thing when it happened because
it
wasn't really happening in movies, and they went and did it again on the MTV Movie Awards.
Yeah. 31 American Gigolo.
Haven't seen that.
Richard Gere. I've seen that once a long time ago, and you see him foot toe naked.
Oh,
yeah?
Yeah. Go ahead, say it.
You see his dick, you do.
Alright, what number are we on?
31.
So 30.
So 30, Maurice.
Didn't see it.
Haven't seen it either. High and Lows of Marlon Brando. Ooh. Sexiest role, Streetcar Named Desire.
Absolutely.
Least sexy role, The Island of Dr. Moreau.
He's
he looks horrible in that, yeah.
That was one of his later films.
Blech. 29, Bound.
Bound. Oh, that's the one with... Jennifer Tilly and
Gina Gershon.
Gershon.
Yeah, I haven't seen that one.
That's a lesbian.
28,
movie.
Love and Basketball.
Didn't see it.
Mm-mm. 27, Unfaithful.
Oh, yeah, with Diane Lane and Richard Gere.
I haven't seen it, but I've,
you heard?
I've heard of it. Yeah.
Is it Richard Gere?
No. Diane Lane and Oliver Martinez.
Okay. No, well, she's got to be cheating on Richard Gere with him.
Oh, I don't know. Didn't say anything about it. 26, The English Patient.
I hear that's a sexy movie, but I haven't seen it.
Ralph Fiennes.
Ray Fiennes.
Ray Fiennes. Kristen Scott Thomas. I don't know.
Kristen Scott Thomas.
25, The Post Postman Always Rings Twice.
Absolutely. Is that the Jack Nicholson one?
Jack Nicholson. Yeah, that's Jessica Lange.
Very sexy fucking movie.
I haven't seen that one.
Because he fucking, he bangs around the kitchen table at the diner, and she's, like, married and shit.
Oh, shit.
This guy. It's that's, like, very early on in the movie. It's a very good movie, too. Huh. So
24 and 9.5 weeks.
Yeah, Kim Basinger and Mickey Rourke, definitely.
Haven't seen that one either. The Age of Innocence.
I haven't seen that. That's a Scorsese
Sounds
movie, though.
Familiar.
Daniel Day-Lewis also.
Daniel Day-Lewis, Michelle Pfeiffer.
But I haven't seen that one.
Huh. Mississippi.
Burning?
No. Masala?
I don't know.
It's an African American. Oh, Denzel Washington. Oh. Mm. I've never seen it. Basic Instinct, 21.
Yep.
Sharon Stone, of course.
Of course. Yeah, that's the big one, too, where they're interrogating.
Yeah, and she uncrosses her legs
and shit.
20 is Titanic.
Okay, for the car?
Sexiest moment, we're torn. It is the scene where Leo sketches Kate nude or the sweaty backseat sex scene in the car. Yeah, it's true. Those are two good scenes. 20. Out of 50, I guess it's not bad.
More
18, Swimming Pool.
I didn't get to see that one.
I don't know what that one is. 16, The 7-Year Itch. I can see that.
Marilyn Monroe.
Yeah, I actually recently just watched that. Sexiest moment during a walk, a gust of wind subway.
Blows up her dress.
Yeah, it blows up her dress.
I've got that movie on Blu-ray.
Notorious, 1946.
Yeah, with Cary Grant, the Alfred Hitchcock movie.
Mm-hmm.
Which scene?
Sexiest moment when Devlin and Alicia stroll out on the balcony above a South American beach. They kiss and don't really stop for the next 2.5 minutes, smooching for 2 seconds here, 3 seconds there, embracing the entire time. What began as a means of avoiding censors became a masterclass in hotness.
Let's look this up.
Okay.
Notorious.
1946.
Notorious kiss. Let's see if that gives it to us. The most rock kiss in movie history. I've been watching this for 3 minutes.
Why? Because this is the most kissing they'd ever seen in a movie or something?
Oh, I have no idea. I've seen this movie. I wasn't a big fan of it, so I don't really remember. And I was probably 11 when I watched this movie.
Huh.
So it's been well over 15 years. But, I mean, they used to do all kinds of
I was telling
tricky
Mike
things.
And I were talking about old-time, like, movies like this and their kissing and how it...
Well, just the creativity.
It wasn't open
mouth.
It was all just, like, you know, you put their lips together and then they just nuzzle each other, basically, the entire time, you know?
Well, you know, it's funny. I mean, in Ghost Train... I don't know if you're okay with
that. Yeah, no, actually, Mike brought that up when we were talking about it. Go ahead.
Mr. Matthews, his note for him and Allie, he was like, you know, we're stuck in time because they were just standing up there and not moving or doing anything. So,
yeah.
So that was like a note that reminded me of what you're talking about.
Yeah.
So they had to sell the kiss a little bit more.
Yeah.
So it looks like they're kind of kissing and talking and shit.
Well, I asked Mike if he's ever had a good kiss on set, and he said that was the best one he had, was with Allie.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's what he said?
Yeah. He's all, because he's like, because there actually was some tongue.
No.
That's what he said.
Really?
Yeah.
Interesting. There's no way. Unless he was the one that did it.
Yeah, he said he did. Wow, that was scandalous.
Oh, looks like they're still kind of nuzzling and cuddling into the other room. Because what does it say that they were trying to make it like a longer kiss scene?
They kiss and don't really stop for the next 2.5 minutes, smooching for 2 seconds here, 3 seconds there, embracing the entire time. What began as a means of avoiding censors became a masterclass in hotness.
Let's see, they're still
because there was a break in between or something. They must the censors were like, okay, fine, that's, you know,
instead
appropriate.
Instead of just like kissing for like 3 minutes, they're able to. I get it.
Okay.
I get it. You know,
he's
on the phone, but they, you know, it doesn't matter, so they're still kissing and everything like that.
But it's like, he's not even. I don't know. Read it to me, babe. It's just weird because they're not actually really kissing. They're just like nuzzling their faces together. It's funny. The most erotic kiss in movie history. Can you imagine what they would have thought of today's movies? Oh my god. Because this is nothing. That's like nothing compared to how horrible. Now you see fucking Leonardo DiCaprio blowing cocaine into some chick's asshole.
Oh, I mean, you get everything nowadays, but like,
you know. No, I know. I see how this could have been. Yeah, I can see how back in the day, but it's like, I look at it now and go, wow, that is so tame.
I don't know. I'm kind of getting into this. Do you have no passion in your life, Kelly?
Yeah, I have no passion in my life. Yes, Matt.
Thank you. All right. Okay, so what's next?
Okay. So Notorious 14, the Year of Living Dangerously.
I haven't seen it.
Mel Gibson.
Oh, really?
Sigourney Weaver.
I have no idea what the fuck it is.
I didn't even know they were in a movie together.
Seriously.
13, Shakespeare in Love. I could see that.
Which scene? Where he's wrapping her up?
Dropping her cross-dressing disguise via, Viola laughs as Will spins her to unwind the bandages around her chest. It's a giddy, tender scene played with irony.
Have you seen that movie?
Yes, I've seen it quite a few times. But yeah, no, I know what scene that is.
That and Titanic were like the big movies that year.
Yeah. Yeah, they both nominated that year. 12, The Fabulous Baker Boys.
I haven't seen it.
Jeff and Beau Bridges, yeah, Michelle Pfeiffer. I've never...
I've heard of it, but I haven't ever seen it.
Once is number 11.
Oh, the Irish film.
Yeah.
What scene? You've never seen this?
Sexiest moment while visiting a music store, they begin to improvise intimately on Hansard's yearning ballad, Falling Slowly.
I don't have it. But it's good.
Alright, number 10, Before Sunset.
Before Sunset, haven't seen it.
Ethan Hawke.
They just put out Before Midnight, the third one. Ethan Hawke and,
What's the sexiest movie musical? Moulin Rouge. Following Chicago and the Rocky Horror Picture Show.
Sure. Yeah, Rocky Horror is really fucking sexy.
Rocky's sexy. That's the only part in that movie I like. 9, Walk on the Moon.
Don't know what that is.
Viggo Mortensen. It's on Netflix. It's actually on my queue. It's a Diane Lane, Viggo Mortensen movie.
Walk on the Moon?
Yeah. Like I said, I want to watch it. It's on my Insta queue.
This one?
Yeah.
99? Let's see if Once is on here. You need to watch Once.
Nope.
Damn. Once bitten.
I actually watched that movie the other day. That was Jim Carrey's first American movie. The Last of the Mohicans, number 8.
I haven't seen that. I've wanted to see that.
It's good, but I don't...
You've seen it?
I have seen it.
Daniel Day-Lewis?
Yeah, I have seen it, but I don't...
You don't think it's that sexy?
Sexiest moment at the fort. Hawkeye seeks out Cora, gazes at her with blunt lust, then leads her up to Nook, where they engage in a makeout session, both intense and tender. So I don't think it was... I don't know.
I don't think it
should be number 8.
No. You're ready to move Dirty Dancing up
further. Yeah, and Titanic. I mean, Titanic's... Yeah. I don't know if I'm going to pronounce this right. Why to Mama Tambien?
Oh, E to Mama Tambien. Haven't seen it.
No.
Spanish.
6, Don't Look Now.
Oh, Donald Sutherland?
Where is it? Donald Sutherland, Julie Christie.
Read it. I've seen that movie.
Sexiest moment? That one. Definitely that one.
They're like having sex the entire movie. Like, it's...
Really?
There's definitely like an awkward sex scene in that movie. 1973?
You won't find a lot of overlap between lists of the scariest films ever and the sexiest. Nicholas...
Rogue?
Yeah.
Or Reg. It's either Reg or Rogue.
Rogue. Creepfest is the exception thanks to an infamous boudoir scene with Donald Sutherland and Julie Christie. It's so suggestively edited that moviegoers still debate whether the duo were in fact actually getting it on.
Yeah, no, it's a really awkward scene to watch.
Huh. Donald Sutherland. That's crazy.
In his prime.
Huh.
It's a good movie, too. It's scary.
Bull Durham.
Kevin Costner.
Susan Sarandon.
Haven't seen it.
Oh, that's that baseball movie.
Yep, it's a baseball
I've seen
movie.
It. Okay. Yeah, I know what scene they're talking about. Sexiest Moment Crashes Ode to the Small of a Woman's Back. Good scotch and long, slow, deep, soft, wet kisses. Yeah, that one. I could see that. Body Heat, number 4.
Sure. That's a good movie, too.
I haven't seen that one.
It's the,
William Hurt.
Yeah, William Hurt. It's a really good
Sexiest
movie.
Sexiest Moments, surprisingly, not any of the R-rated ones, but Turner and Hurt training.
It's a really good crime thriller. It's worth watching. And Mickey Body Rourke, Heat. That's like one of his first movies.
Yeah.
And he's really good in, like, the one scene that he's in. That I mean, that's, like, how he got so popular. It's, like, from that one scene.
That one scene,
yeah.
Mr. and Mrs. Smith is number 3.
What, where they're fighting off?
Sexiest, yeah, angry, aroused, and armed to the teeth. They hit the dance floor to...
Oh, so it's not
to pat each other down, quips hubby to touchy-feely wife. That's all John, sweetheart. I don't actually really like that movie very much.
No, it wasn't too great. It was okay.
2 is His Girl Friday.
Oh, with Cary Grant and Rosalind Russell?
Yeah.
I haven't seen it. I want to see it really bad. I love classical movies.
Hmm. And then number 1 is Out of Sight, the George Clooney, Jennifer Lopez.
Have you seen that?
I haven't.
It's pretty good, too. Michael Keaton's in it. He's playing the same character from Jackie Brown. Have you seen Jackie Brown?
Mm-mm.
What the fuck? Quentin Tarantino, Jackie Brown? Are you living
under a
rock?
I have seen this. Maybe I have bits and pieces of it.
Are they in a trunk or something? It's a pretty good movie. It's been a while, but I hate Jennifer Lopez so much.
Yeah, I don't either. The first is, of course, the Jenny and George in the trunk of a car scene. They spin with an instant intimacy that surprises both of them and us. Meeting cute in a unique setting, there becomes one of the most erotically charged moments of modern movies. Another comes in a hotel lounge at night. Soderbergh, I think that's it.
Yeah.
Flashes forward from their flirtatious conversation to scenes of the lovemaking that results as soon as they leave the bar. The talk and the act exist simultaneously, voluptuously.
Exaggerated.
Out of Sight is a crackerjack thriller, but it's also a cinematic. How do I pronounce that? Shut up.
Where's that? Aphrodisiac.
Okay. It's downright dangerously sexy.
Downright.
Hmm.
So it's not like the easiest list for us to go over since we haven't seen. Like,
so yeah, I haven't seen more than half of these.
Yeah.
Huh.
But you know, they're only basing it off of just like specific scenes.
Yeah. I mean, like, it's cool they did like the one scene wonders, so that because some of these, yeah.
How old is that issue? Check the front.
Well, it's to Melissa, so it's obviously a couple years. Oh, 2008. November 2008.
November of 2008.
Yeah. I was still in high school. Oh, yay, yay. Look, they had a thing about Twilight on here. That's how old it is.
Oh, is that a review for Twilight?
Yeah.
What did they give
it? The first Twilight.
Right, what did the review say? Is there... No,
B.
There should be...
Gave
they gave it a B?
B?
They gave Twilight a B.
Yeah.
I've got other issues with other lists on it, too.
They, like, rate the vampires. Neck at Night, How Scary Are Vampires on Film? Robert Pattinson's hunky vampire in this week's Twilight, a lover, not a biter. But we still wouldn't want to get on his bad side. Here's how he measures up to the other movie vamps on the fright scale. So not even a goosebump is Leslie Nielsen from Dracula Dead and loving it.
Sure.
Next one is Lauren Hutton in Once Bitten, which is that Jim Carrey movie I was talking about. Eddie Murphy, Vampire in Brooklyn. And then it's Robert Pattinson's Twilight. And then it's Tom Cruise, Interview with the Vampire. Gary Oldman's Bram Stoker's Dracula. And the last one's Danny Hudson in 30 Days a Night. That's the most scariest.
Danny Houston.
Maximum Terror. And then Robert Pattinson's kind of scary.
There you go.
Oh, gosh. Twilight and True Blood.
Well, no, there's a list of the 20.
Oh, 20.
So we'll
all right,
go
we'll go over that. Wait, is something else good in here?
It's like a flashback to 2008, Kelly. Were you watching those TV shows that night?
Mm-mm.
That week?
No, I... What did I watch in high school? I watched That 70s Show.
What year did you graduate?
2010.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
I was a sophomore in 2008.
Holy fuck. Well, you would have been a junior, right? Fall 2008?
Fall 2008, I was a junior.
Yeah, and that's from November?
Yeah, so I would have been a junior. Weird.
Because you're only now going to be turning 22 here in a couple months, right?
Yeah. Oh, James Morrison. All right.
We know you love James Morrison.
Yep, he's got really nice eyes.
Oh, God. I'm sure it's eyes that you care about.
All right, where is it? Oh, Emma Watson. Mike has a crush on Emma Watson.
From Nancy Drew?
No, from Harry Potter.
Who the fuck is... Oh, Emma Roberts, so I'm thinking of.
She's the crappy one. I don't like her.
She's Eric Roberts' good actress at all. Yeah,
she's niece.
She's a, no, Eric Roberts' daughter.
Oh, Julia I thought you said Julia. Yeah. I thought you said Julia Roberts. Yeah. All right, so...
We gotta start from the back again?
Meryl Streep. Yeah, we have to start from the... Why do they do that? It's weird.
Yeah, because then it's like,
you
oh...
Be, you want to lead up to, like, right the number the, yeah, one,
exactly,
you know?
Exactly, exactly.
Okay. So top 20, okay.
Top 20 vampire films of all time?
Okay. Okay, well, let's do the honorable mentions really quick. So, how would we... So, Grandpa Munster.
Okay.
Count Von Count.
From?
From Sesame Street.
Oh, okay.
Elvira.
Okay.
And Forgetting Sarah Marshall.
Oh, the musical?
Yeah, the... Musical yeah, Dracula. The musical Dracula. So number 20 is Caleb and May. From 1987's Near Dark.
Oh, that's 20. That's like my favorite vampire movie of really? All time.
Yeah, that's.
It's funny.
Yeah, number 20. Dark. 19 is Celine from Underworld. So Kate Beckinsale.
She's pretty good.
Yeah, I like her. Another crush of Mike's. He would leave me for her any day. 18 Countess Bathory from Daughters of Darkness.
I don't think I've seen that.
Mm-mm. 1971. Eli from... Is it Eli or Ellie?
Eli.
It just doesn't have the... Okay. Let the Right One In.
Let the Right One In. That's a damn good movie.
I haven't seen that one. 16 Blade from Blade
okay,
Trilogy.
Sure. He's okay. I don't think he's better than, like, Kate Beckinsale or the yeah. other ones. There's no... Near Dark has got to be number one.
It's 20.
I know, but it should be number one. Maybe it is backwards. Yeah, that's what it is.
No, yeah. It's, yeah, sure. 15 is Miriam Blaylock and Sarah Roberts in The Hunger.
I didn't see that one. That's Tony Scott's first movie.
That's
David Bowie.
David Bowie, yeah. I've seen bits and pieces of it. I haven't seen it all the way through. My parents have it on DVD. David from Lost Boys, number 14.
Absolutely.
Jean-Claude from Hamilton's Anita Blake Vampire Hunter series.
No.
13.
That's like a book.
Zoe Redbird from Kristen Katz House of Night series. I don't know.
It's the 20 greatest vampires of all time.
Okay, so not necessarily from movies.
There you go.
So readers poll, who's the hottest new vampire?
Is there a list or just the one?
There's a... So, how would I do this? 42% is for Eric from True Blood. I've never seen True Blood, so
Eric
I don't
Malcolm.
Know. Yeah. Twilight 35, it's Edward. Bill from True Blood is 10. Damon from Vampire Diaries is 8.
Never saw that show.
I've seen a couple episodes. It's stupid. Vampire Diaries, Stefan, yeah, they're all dumb. All these...
I know everybody fucking loves... Where is he? Him. Everybody fucking loves
from True
him.
Blood?
I mean, he obviously has the most.
Yeah, he does. I've never seen it, so I don't know.
You don't think that guy's hot?
No, I don't.
Don't lie.
I don't.
You're going to watch True Blood when you leave. Or do you have to work tonight?
I don't work tonight.
Okay.
Mm-mm. Klaus Kinski's Dracula?
Klaus Kinski?
Klaus.
Nosferatu?
Ugh. Blech. Blech. He is creepy. Number 10, Gary Oldman's Dracula?
Sure.
And 9, I'm going to pronounce this wrong. Is it Schuller Van Allen?
Sure. Schuller sounds right.
Schuller. Blue Blood series.
Yeah, I don't know what that is. So that's obviously a book.
Summer 8, Mr. Barlow from Salem's Lot.
Hell yeah.
I haven't seen that one. Angel.
Well, also, I mean, it's a book. Angel from Angel.
Seven
Buffy.
Angel. Hey, is that, that's the guy from Bones, right?
Yeah, Boreanaz.
And then 6, Asa Vajad, Black Sunday.
Don't know.
I don't know half of these. I don't know any of these. Bill and Eric from True Blood.
Sure.
4 is Edward Cullen from Twilight.
He was so fucking popular when that first movie came out, and everybody hates that shit now.
That's what they make such... They've made... It's just been overplayed. It's just been overdone.
Absolutely.
So much.
Yeah.
Bela Lugosi is 3.
Okay.
2 is Christopher Lee's Dracula.
Okay. Number 1 has got to be... Let me guess. Is it new or old?
It's Lestat.
Okay. I'm fine with that.
From, yeah, Interview with a Vampire.
Even though
Which
I like
surprises me. I'm
more.
Surprised that actually he's actually...
Worthy?
That he's up farther than Edward Cullen. That surprises me.
Well, Edward's like, what, 5?
He's 4. He actually goes above True Blood. True Blood's 5. That's interesting.
True Blood is good.
Harry Potter!
So that's got the 20...
20 scariest villains. 20 coolest heroes. Pages.
So I got these memorial issues. Paul Newman.
Paul Newman.
Heath Ledger.
Oh dang, Patrick Swayze. Okay. Wait.
Did you lose it?
No, nope, there's something else.
The Dark Knight Rises.
Nicolas Cage's hair, a real national treasure.
What are you looking at? Is that part of our list?
I finally watched Peggy Sue Got Married. Have you seen that?
Yeah, I love that movie.
His voice bugs me. Yeah, his voice bugs me in that movie. I don't know why he changed it. It was a good movie.
Because he's playing younger.
But look at his hair. It's so funny.
Oh, that's Peggy Sue.
That's Peggy Sue.
Oh, these are all pictures of him.
Yeah, and then Valley Girl, Con Air, Raising Arizona.
Wild at Heart. That's Weatherman.
Adaptation? Oh, no.
That's Weatherman.
It's Weatherman?
Yeah.
What's this one?
That's Adaptation.
Okay.
And then underneath it, that's...
Snake Eyes?
No, it's Wild at Heart. And then...
Where's Moonstruck? That's Moonstruck.
Does it say Wild at Heart on here?
Yeah, it does. Number 5. Unless so you have to match it up. That's funny. That's funny.
Have you seen that
like
shit
now. A long time ago I did.
Oh, his hairline's totally receding now. Totally.
Oh yeah, his hair looks like shit. He needs to just shave it off.
Shave his head.
I can't find the villains thing in here.
Let me look.
I think I might have passed it.
Well, clearly if you're at the end and you didn't find it. Like a retard.
You're a retard.
A re-re. As we say. What's that for? Walk the line?
Jessica Biel and Colin Firth Tango? What movie is that?
Oh, that's the...
Jane Austen?
Noel Coward movie.
Virtue?
No. Easy Virtue.
Easy Virtue. What's next? Oh, that's the year his wife died. Sad face.
Oh, Liam Neeson's wife?
Yeah.
Natasha Kinski? No, Natasha Richardson? No, Natasha something.
Which is sad because, like... So it's sad now that when I watch, like, Love Actually, because his wife dies in that movie.
Yeah.
It's kind of sad to watch. That was way before that even happened.
Yeah.
I don't think it's in here. I don't see it. Okay, right, heroes and villains. Here we go. Huh, that's kind of a cool picture. Evil Queen, Darth Vader, Superman, Joker. McCain.
John
McClane. Yeah, McClane. Okay, so... I don't have that number. It's just Harry Potter versus...
Right there. There you go.
Top 20 heroes. I'm going to have to go
start
backwards
the back.
Again.
Okay.
Okay.
Number 20.
Number 20, Sydney Bristow.
From what?
From Why Her?
No, I think that's saying why.
Okay, Why Her, Jennifer Garner's Hossie Butt-Kicking Double
alias.
Triple Alias. Oh, okay. Best accessory, any spandex clothing item, preferably red. Atticus Finch.
To Kill a Mockingbird.
Kill a Mockingbird. Copycat, Descendant, A Time to Kill Jake Tyler.
That's from.
Oh, okay. Number 18 is Batman.
Of course.
Best accessory. This is a Batarangs.
Batarangs.
And because they are called Batarangs. What is that?
A Batarang. What is it? Like, those little Batarangs that he throws.
Oh, okay.
Riri?
Shut up. 17 is Nancy Drew.
Okay.
Copycat, Descendants, Scooby-Doo's Velma and Veronica Mars, yeah.
Absolutely.
14 is Will Kane.
From High Noon.
Yep, from High Noon. Most heroic move when Kane last Allie gets cold feet. He tells him to go home to his family and then refuses to help of a teenager. I don't know what that is. In High Noon?
The Western.
High Noon. Oh, I've never seen it. 13, Foxy Brown.
Okay. Foxy Brown from Foxy Brown.
Is that her, I'm assuming?
That's her.
Okay.
Pam Grier.
12, Captain James T. Kirk. Most heroic move, repeatedly saving Federation's bacon, acing the...
Corvallite maneuver?
Yeah, scenario. Biggest weakness, freaky alien babes.
Absolutely.
11 is Mad Max.
Okay.
The best accessory is souped up muscle car. Biggest weakness, poor fuel efficiency. Copycat, Descendants, Kevin Costner in Waterworld. Yeah. Kevin Costner in The Postman. Kevin Costner. 10 is Spider-Man.
Okay.
Most heroic move, risking life and limb to stop a runaway L train in Spider-Man 2. Least heroic move, the alien goop-prompted emo strut he whips out in Spider-Man 3. Oh my goodness. That was ridiculous. That movie was stupid. God, I hated that. I remember sitting in theaters. I can still see myself sitting there going, what the fuck is he doing? Like, seriously, he's strutting and his hair's all, like, hanging down on his face and... ridiculous.
Did you see that when it came out?
I did.
Did you see it at the summit?
No, I think I saw it at Sparks.
Because that was like when the summit first opened. That was like the first movie.
No, I don't think so. Who did I go see it with? I can't remember who I went and saw it with. Had to have been a boyfriend. Anyway, number...
You've had so many.
I've had 3. Shut up. Number 9 is Robin Hood.
Okay.
1930s Adventures of Robin Hood.
That's a good one.
Most heroic moment, men, if you're willing to fight for our people, I want you. Best accessory, his pose of merry men. Worst accessory, his green tights. Biggest weakness, fair maidens.
That says posse.
Posse. Yep, his posse of merry men, you're right. This is why I have you around.
You're Riri.
Shut up. Number 8 is Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Absolutely.
Most heroic move to protect her sister and humanity. She jumps off. She jumps to her temporary death in a snarling portal of evil.
Yep.
Number 7 is Han Solo.
Sure.
Most heroic moment, not a bad bit of rescuing, huh? You know, sometimes I amaze even myself. Best accessory, Wookiee sidekick.
Yeah, okay.
6 is John McClane.
There's some good heroes.
That's yeah. Most heroic, quote, APKA motherfucker. Copycat, Descendants, Keanu Reeves in Speed. Wesley Snipes in Passenger. Jean-Claude Van Damme in Sudden Death. And so on. That's a lot of them.
Etc.
5, Ellen Ripley.
From Alien.
From Alien, yeah. The most heroic quote, get away from her, you bitch.
Absolutely.
Best accessory, the exoskeleton-ish power loader she uses to pummel the alien queen into the airlock in Aliens.
I love that shit.
Number 4, Harry Potter.
Nope.
Most heroic movie. Oh, come on. Yeah, he is. He is way up there now. He's popular. Most heroic move, obliterating Voldemort by deploying a secret weapon. Love, loyalty, and the good old Expelliarmus. Yeah, this is from the second one, I'm pretty sure.
Well, or the third? This was before the last movie was even out. You were still in high school.
Yeah.
April 2009.
Biggest weakness, misses his mommy and daddy.
Yeah, that's his biggest weakness, because he's a little crybaby.
Number 3 is Superman.
Definitely.
Most heroic move, when he saves California from falling into the sea. No, it's when he gives his life to stop Doomsday for destroying Metropolis. No way, it's being Superman. Least heroic move, Superman, for the quest for peace.
Yeah, the fourth movie.
The fourth one. Ah, oh, yes, I agree with this one. Indiana Jones.
Number two.
Best accessory: bullwhip coiled up at the hip. Copycat Descendants, Romancing the Stone. Totally.
Never saw it. Or Jewel of the Nile.
Tomb Raider, Lara Croft.
King Solomon.
Number one, James Bond.
James Bond is the number one hero.
Is the number one hero. I could see it.
He usually is.
Most heroic quote. Do you mind if my friend sits this one out? She's just dead. Least heroic quote. That's as bad as listening to the Beatles without earmuffs. Best accessory, the Aston Martin with the pop-off top. Worst accessory, Goldfinger's powder blue terry cloth jumpsuit. So obviously they're talking, this is the Sean Connery James Bond.
Yeah, well that, yeah.
Yeah.
But I'm pretty sure they're talking about
all of them,
Sean
yeah.
Sean Connery is the classic James Bond.
Yeah, Indiana Jones, I like that. That's a good run-up. All right.
I see that number one.
It's only 20, okay. So.
What's that on the other page?
Rogues Gallery?
Oh, you got Anthony Hopkins, Louise Fletcher, so One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Sharon Stone and Malcolm McDowell.
Basic Instinct.
Basic Instinct.
And
The Clockwork Orange. Alright, so Jack Torrance.
Number 20.
Most evil quote.
Was there a reader's poll for heroes?
Oh yeah, there is. Let's do it. Reader's poll. Top 10 villains is voted by readers. Number 1 is the Joker. 2 is Darth Vader. 4 is Maleficent. 5, Benjamin Linus. 6, Hannibal Lecter. 7,
Benjamin Linus.
Yeah, I don't know what that is. 7 is Hans Gruber. 8 is Lex Luthor. 9, Emperor Palpatine. And 10, the Wicked Witch of the West. The Joker's number 1. Darth Vader's 2. Sorry, I think Darth Vader's the
number 1. Lost.
Oh, Lost. Okay, so that's him then, that picture. I didn't know that was...
I've never watched Lost.
I've never seen either. All right. So who's Jack Torrance? Where is that?
Jack Torrance, the Shining.
Okay. Gotcha. I just don't remember the names.
That's what I'm here
least
for.
Badass move, enjoys typing, biggest weakness, poor at mazes. 19 is
poor
Alex
mazes?
Forrest. Yeah.
Oh, poor at mazes.
Yeah.
Okay, gotcha.
Alex Forrest from Fatal Attraction.
Okay.
Most evil move, boiling the bunny.
Yeah, the bunny boiler.
Biggest weakness, wives who stand by their man. Copycat Descendants, Rebecca. In the Hand That Rocks the Cradle, Drew Barrymore and Poison Ivy.
Okay.
Drew Barrymore was in a movie called Poison Ivy?
I guess. I mean, Poison Ivy's like, I think it's about, like, a young girl seducing an older guy.
Interesting. Gordon Gekko?
Wall Street. Michael Douglas.
Oh, I haven't seen that. Is it good?
A lot of people like it, but there's a lot of Wall Street stuff in there that I was just not interested in.
Most evil quote, greed is good. Least badass move, getting outsmarted by Charlie Sheen.
Yeah, pretty much. Wall Street, if you're interested.
Michael Myers.
Halloween.
17. Best accessories: a big freaking knife and customized Captain Kirk mask.
Yes.
Copycat Descendants. Freddy Krueger.
Freddy Krueger, Jason.
Mm-hmm.
Leatherface.
16. Hans Gruber.
Die Hard.
Most evil quote: Mr. What is it?
Oh, is it Takahashi?
Yeah, won't be joining us for the rest of his life. Best accessories, his two suits
off.
From John Phillips London. Rumor has it, Arafat, is it?
Yasser Arafat?
Buys his there. Biggest weakness, he could talk about men's fashion all day. Snow White's queen, the evil queen.
Okay. She never had a name?
No, she's the evil queen. Most evil move, demanding a hunter cut out Snow White's heart and deliver it to her in a special box.
Yeah.
Copycat Descendants, Sleeping Beauty's Maleficent, The Little Mermaid's Ursula, 101 Dalmatians' Cruella de Vil. She's the one that started it all. I mean, just like Snow White started it all, she was the first evil, yeah, the first villain in Disney. And she's actually the Once Upon a Time that I watched.
She's the lead villain.
She's the lead villain, yeah.
Okay. Did you ever watch that Julia Roberts movie?
Oh, Mirror Mirror.
Is it Mirror Mirror?
Yeah, it was. It's stupid. It's not very good. Yeah.
Did you see Snow White and the Huntsman too?
I have.
Which movie?
I saw it once. Snow White and the Huntsman. Yeah, no, Mirror Mirror. Mirror Mirror. It's made for children. It's definitely made for children. It's not. I like the more serious, like Snow White, movies, because that one's, it's really kind of cheesy. Army Hammer's in it. He's the only good part in it. He's nice to look at. So.
Oh God, here we go.
You
are getting ridiculous. You know that.
He's a hunk. Sorry. 14, Annie Wilkes from Misery.
Yep. Have you seen Misery?
I have seen Misery. Most evil move, breaking both of Paul's ankles with a sledgehammer, then calmly saying, God, I love you. Least badass move, use of the words cockadoody, dirty bird, and oogie. 13, Frank Booth. From Blue Velvet.
That's you.
Fuck that movie, man.
That's you. You're Frank Booth.
Best accessory, creepy oxygen mask.
Yeah.
Most evil move, his nitrous-fueled mommy-issued assault on Isabella.
Yeah.
Please don't make us describe it any more detail.
Daddy wants to fuck.
Oh, God.
You fucker. Don't look at me, fucker.
Sounds like something Patrick would say. 12, Norman Bates from Psycho. Okay. Most evil move, shower side. Least badass move, being not just a transvestite, but a dowdy transvestite.
It's like a flower dress thing.
Have you watched the TV series?
No, it's on Netflix now.
Is it on Netflix now?
Yes.
Because there's a whole new season that just came out, and actually, I think I want to watch it too. That's on my
list. Yeah, because they show, when I was up in Oregon.
Well, I saw a commercial for it when I went and saw,
Yeah, like, they did, like, a making of
season
2, and it looked fucking good.
Yeah, it does look really good. Really, I like, he's good. A really great actor, too.
I wouldn't say he's a great actor, but...
He's a great actor.
He's just a kid.
He's, like, a year older than me, I think. Well, no, probably, like, a year younger than me.
But, no,
but he's a really good child, but he was a really good child actor.
He was only in, like, one movie.
No, he wasn't.
He, like, disappeared after Charlie and the Chocolate
Factory. He was in Funny Neverland...
Yeah.
And he was in It, and he was in,
Freddie Highmore.
What else was he in? He was in a bunch of other stuff.
I'll just click on his name here, but I agree with you, because that second season looked fucking intense. So, 92? When were you born?
August Rush, that's the only thing about Spiderwick.
You were born in 90.
Oh, he is...
Three?
He's older than me, by a couple months.
So you were born in 92.
I'm May 92.
Oh, so he was born on Valentine's Day.
Okay, so yeah, he's a couple months older than me. So he's 21, turning 22.
Yeah, like, who saw any of these? Arthur 3? I mean,
well, he's a British actor.
Astro Boy,
Spiderwick, Fox. But these are, I mean, those are all child. But he's getting into the more Golden adult Compass. Stuff now. He was in a movie with Emma Roberts, which was really good.
Oh, he was in A Good Year. Did you see A Good Year? Oh my God, no. I love that fucking movie. With Russell Crowe?
Uh-oh.
It's a romance movie, and it's by Ridley Scott directed. I love this fucking movie.
Who's the woman in it?
From Batman?
The French girl?
Yeah.
I don't know, Renee. I know who you're talking about, though.
Marion Cotillard. Yeah, she's the chick in this. Oh, it's such a good fucking movie. I can't believe you haven't seen this.
No, I need to. It's on Netflix, isn't it?
It might be, but if not, I have it, because I love it.
Okay.
I should watch it. I want to watch it now. Oh, man. I always forget about it, but I do love this fucking movie. It's so good. It's cute. It's a very cute movie.
Okay, I'll have to watch it.
What's the Emma Roberts movie? Or is it Emma Roberts?
I have to go up.
So it's later on.
Yeah, he was older in it. He was much older in it. He wasn't a child.
The Art of Getting By.
The Art of Getting By. That's what
and
it
you've
was.
Have you seen it?
Yeah.
Why?
I mean, why? Because I like him.
I've never even
so
heard
I watched
of this
it.
Fucking movie.
It's sad.
So you sought it out, is what you did?
And it was on one day, and I was like, oh, I don't want to see this.
Claire Underwood's in it. Rita Wilson's in it. Alicia Silverstone's in it.
Okay. She plays the teacher.
Yeah, Faith Motel.
So anyway, yeah. I want to see it, though, too.
Yes. Well, now you can start on season one.
Yeah, once I'm done with Once Upon a Time, I'll start it. J.R. Ewing? Dallas?
Yeah, Dallas, J.R. Ewing.
Most evil move, having wife Sue Ellen institutionalized. Best accessories, a cowboy hat and a glass of bourbon and Branch. Isn't that like a new TV show now? Like they're redoing it?
No, they continued it.
Oh, okay.
But then he died.
Oh, that's right. The actor. Yeah, okay. Ten, Nurse Ratched from One Floor with the Cuckoo's Nest.
Fucking A.
Most Evil Move shows no remorse after Billy Bibbit kills himself in fear of her telling his mom that he was...
Have you seen One Floor with the Cuckoo's Nest?
Yeah, and I've read it. I've read the book a couple times, too.
I've got the play.
Dracula.
Number what?
Nine. Best accessory, the cape, perfect for menacing swishing noises. Biggest weakness, stakes, not a fan. Number eight, Voldemort.
Okay.
Most evil move, killing Harry Potter's parents. Biggest weakness, motherly love.
I don't get it.
Because that's the only reason he couldn't kill Harry. His mom.
Okay, because she loved Harry.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
All right. Catherine Tremel from Basic Instinct.
That's Sharon Stone, I'm assuming.
Yeah.
Or is it Jean Triplehorn?
I didn't say.
Because she's the bad guy. Jean Triplehorn's the bad guy.
She's the ultimate.
It's gotta be Jean
Triplehorn. It's
gotta be, yeah. But they have Sharon Stone, like.
There's no picture of her, though. I don't know.
I can do this.
Well, Sharon Stone's on there
because of the article and everything.
Yeah.
Well, what's the name?
Catherine Tremel.
Yeah, that's Sharon Stone.
Okay. Mr. Burns from The Simpsons.
What?
Most evil quote, release the hounds.
Release the hounds.
Biggest weakness, unhealthy obsession with Bobo, his childhood teddy bear.
And number...
Number five, Alex DeLarge
from... Clockwork Orange.
Biggest weakness, Beethoven's Ninth Symphony.
That's it. Can you say squirrel? You can't say symphony, but you can say squirrel.
Symphony. Number four, the Joker. Most evil quote from The Dark Knight. See, I'm not a monster. I'm just ahead of the curve. Hannibal Lecter is number three.
He's usually number one.
Most evil quote. A census taker once tried to test me. I ate his liver with some fava beans and a nice...
That's Chianti.
Chianti, is that what it is?
Chianti.
Number two is Darth Vader.
And number one?
Most evil quote, give yourself to the dark side. Least badass move, his initial act after first donning the classic black suit in Revenge of the Sith.
No!
Breaking down like a... God, that...
Oh, who cares? I've got no problem with it.
I fucking hate it. Breaking down...
I wish that was...
Like a little girl upon learning movie. About the death of his wife. And the only reason that's even in there is because George Lucas is a dickhead.
Oh, it's in there because he's a dickhead.
Yeah, it's because he's fucking stupid and he's... Oh, let's have freaking Hayden Christensen be Darth Vader.
I think it's the best part of that movie.
It's fucking dumb. You're just saying that because you, like, getting a rise out of me. Alright, number one is The Wicked Witch of the West, which she kind of did start everything. I mean, that was the first real evil, like, colored... Like,
colored? Are you racist?
Colored TV, you dick.
Colored TV.
Let's see. Most evil quote, I'll get you, my pretty, and your little dog, too. Lee's badass move, cowering just because Glenda, the good witch, gave her the stink eye. Biggest weakness, if you want a water ballet partner, she's not your gal. Yeah, it's so easy.
You're
like,
when you read.
You know what? Fuck you. I don't read that often anymore. And I'm kind of, like, trying to talk without having a nasally voice right now.
You sound fine. I can't even tell.
Good.
So no one else can. But now they're going to go back and listen.
Shut up.
That's just about it. I mean, I've got these. These ones are kind of old and dated.
Slumdog Millionaire.
Slumdunder Mifflinair. Are you going to read on this podcast, Kelly?
Sound bites.
What are you looking at?
Oh, it's a picture of Neil Patrick Harris. It says, if I could nail any celebrity, it would definitely be Scarlett Johansson. Hot, talented, and nobody does that many Woody Allen movies without serious daddy issues.
Serious
Barney
daddy
from
issues.
How I Met Your Mother.
She's in two, I think. She's in two Woody Allen movies.
You know, I've actually never seen any Woody Allen movies.
That's not necessarily true. Maybe you just don't know.
Maybe.
So we'll look it up. I just watched one today.
Blue Jasmine. Yeah, I mean, I know some of them. But I seriously don't think I've seen any. I know references to them.
All right. So, To Rome with Love.
Nope.
Midnight in Paris.
Nope.
You'll Meet a Tall, Dark Stranger.
Nope.
It's a short. Whatever Works.
Nope.
Vicky Christie Barcelona.
Mm-mm.
Cassandra's Dream.
Nope.
Scoop.
Nope.
Match Point.
Nope.
And those are the two Scarlett Johansson's. Melinda and Melinda. Anything else?
Nope.
Hollywood Ending.
Nope.
The Curse of the Jade Scorpion.
Uh-uh.
Small Time Crooks.
Nope.
Sweet and Lowdown.
Nope.
Celebrity.
I'm telling you, I haven't seen any of his movies.
Deconstructing Harry. Everyone Says I Love You. Mighty Aphrodite. Bullets Over Broadway. Manhattan Murder Mystery. Husbands and Wives. Shadows and Fog. I let you borrow Shadows and Fog.
Nope.
Alice. Crimes and Misdemeanors. Another Woman. September. Radio Days. Hannah and Her Sisters. Purple Rose of Cairo, which I bought and need to watch. Broadway Danny Rose. Zelig, I've seen. Midsummer's Night Sex Comedy. Stardust Memories, which I want to watch. Manhattan is an amazing movie.
It's on Netflix. It's on my Insta queue.
Is it on Netflix?
Mm-hmm.
I fucking love that movie. I think it's his best one. Yeah, that is it. Interiors, and Annie Hall, of course, is the one who won the Oscar for. Or at least Annie Hall won Best Picture. Sleeper, Love and Death, Played Again Sam. Bananas. Biscuit, Biscuit, I Love You. No, none of these? You haven't seen shit?
No, I told you, I haven't seen any of his movies.
Not even any of these new ones? You never saw Midnight in Paris?
Nope.
With Owen Wilson?
Nope.
The Owen Wilson film?
Nope.
This one?
Nope.
Never saw it?
Mm-mm.
Nominated?
I know about it, but I haven't seen it.
Alright, well, we just shot through another episode, so let's do this, and we'll call it a day. My mom never texted me back, that cunt.
Oh. That's mean.
This is how we talk to each other.
That's horrible. I hate that word. I hate it.
You should never hate bad words.
I hate that word. I really don't like it. There's no male equivalent to that word.
It's whatever bothers you is what the equivalent is to whatever bothers you.
I guess that's kind of true, but still, that there's nothing worse, I feel like. What number?
21. So right where we left off. From Smodcast 10, eating a chicken's soul. Does a chicken have a soul? The way we see a bear or a shark, do you think that's the way chickens look at human beings? That there's a comunicado that goes in the chicken world where they're like, the human's coming at you, pick up a bite, make yourself look big.
Well, they don't have any arms, really. I think that's why chickens run. If you walk in, chickens don't like...
So they've got the fight or flight response. They've got the flight aspect.
It's like, there's something large coming in here. We've got to move. Or if you bring them food, they're still timid, but some birds will come and eat out of your hand. I mean, they still have senses to sense the difference between us coming in there and, say, a coyote or something.
Right.
But to a chicken, we're just a big, huge thing.
What's the difference between a human and a coyote to a chicken? Both of us are coming to eat them. The coyote sooner rather than later.
Well, if you have a chicken coop, you're just coming in to get eggs. You're not slaughtering them in front of everybody.
But isn't there a part of them that's like, protect the young, they're taking our babies?
I don't think chickens...
You don't think chickens have emotions?
The chicken brain is not the most developed.
I gotta imagine the chicken has to have emotions. The chicken has to feel like...
Or you want to think.
I really do! Part of me wants to, and a part of me doesn't want to, because I eat a lot of chicken. Part of me wants to believe that the chicken is sitting on a bunch of eggs, and then some asshole comes in and is stealing them.
Like, naming them?
Totally. This will be Herbert, this will be George, this would be Francis.
Most people who eat chicken tend to not think that they have emotions. Usually it's people who don't eat meat who have the impression that...
The chicken has a soul.
Yeah, the media is just that they're dumb fucking things pecking around shooting out eggs.
Yeah, I'm a happy medium where I've got to believe that there's more going on in a chicken.
You want to eat their soul.
Here it comes, it's the fat soul sucker, hide the babies, oh he's back, he took Bertha. Yeah, I don't want to necessarily eat their souls. But I have a hard time thinking the chicken is just sitting there, goop, brip.
That's hard to imagine.
Christ, man, you gotta think like it's a living being. It has a brain, a higher function. If we were a jellyfish-eating world, I'd be fine. A jellyfish does not have a brain or a spine. I still don't understand how a jellyfish works. I was at the aquarium with the kid, and I read something like, the jellyfish has no brain, no heart, no spine. I'm like, the jellyfish is like me. But I have those things, but in theory I'm spineless and heartless and brainless, but this thing literally has. How does that fucking thing exist? It's a freak of nature. Just this thing that lives and eats other things, but it doesn't have a brain, it doesn't have a heart, and it doesn't have a spine? What the fuck makes a jellyfish work?
It's an arrangement of cells. Look at bacteria. Bacteria is a living thing, but they don't have any spines or brains.
No brain whatsoever.
If a jellyfish doesn't have a brain, I'm not going to vote for bacteria not having a brain.
Yeah, a jellyfish is weird. So I could see a jellyfish just bleep, just floating in the ocean. Bleep, bleep, bleep. Even that's giving it too much because there's an inflection in bleep, 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 bleep.
It'd be robotic. It'd be like bleep, bleep.
No, man. They don't even make noises. But a chicken, there's got to be like when you leave and the chickens are alone, there must be like, hey, what's up? How are you? We're still alive. We're still doing it. They haven't eaten us yet. Let's work on our escape plan, like Chicken Run, like the dream, the Aardman animation.
I'd say that this is proof positive that they don't fucking do that.
Why?
Well, I mean, I've never heard of them doing that. In the age of the internet, we should do the research, and maybe someone can write in with their stories of chickens fucking doing elaborate escape plans.
I'm not even looking for that. I'm looking for, has anyone ever buried a mic in a chicken coop? Not let them know, like built a chicken coop with a microphone in it, hidden throughout the place? A bunch of mics, and then brought the chickens in there and be like, we're just going to eat your eggs, and that's it, and then maybe we'll eat you sometime, or whatever. Just treat them like normal chickens. Don't let them know that the jig is up, and then walk away, and then see if the chickens say anything when the door closes.
In English?
Wait a good minute. Whatever, any language. Even if they spoke Chinese, I think it would be wicked if they were suddenly like, they're gone. Chinese. Tonking, tonking. Yeah, I'd take that. But still, you'd get somebody to translate it to find out what chickens say to one another. And the conversations they would have, like, just, look at my dick, look at my chicken dick. Whatever, I don't need them formulating fucking math equations, but if I could relate to a chicken a little more.
Would you even eat them then?
No, I would stop eating them. I'd be like, holy shit, these things talk, they know English, they've just been waiting all this time to pull the whole Planet of the Apes.
But if we found out the chickens were just like, hey Fred, how are you doing?
Hey Fred, look at my dick, watch me jerk off. I imagine a dirty chicken.
Dirty chickens. If that did happen, then I don't think you would want that because you would have nothing to eat.
No, I would eat box cereal.
You'd eat box cereal.
I would live off fucking Kellogg's.
What if you found out if we'd mic'd the grain?
And they spoke?
Yeah.
Then I'd have to reevaluate.
You know what's funny about corn is that they think that most sugar-based cereals are heavenly corn-based.
Yeah, that's when they grind them up. I'll eat corn when you grind it up, but it's that texture. If you grind it and dry it up, yeah, I'll eat cornmeal. I'll eat that raw. Just give me a fistful of cornmeal and I'll eat it, like a chicken would. That's why I relate to the chicken very much.
And what are you hoping is that you could be left in a coop and be like, let me see your dick.
Totally. I would like to go incognito into a chicken coop and rattle large chickens.
You're a chicken... You're a chicken fetishist.
Look, let's not be ridiculous. You don't even need to be in a big chicken outfit. Let's say they built into the coop a place where I could just put my head. My body's outside the coop, resting comfortably. My head is sitting on a nest, and you know, like, we know some special effects dudes. They decorate my head, they do me up so I look like a chicken.
But your face is like the belly.
Yes, but I'm wearing white contact lenses, so it just blends in with the feathers and shit like that. So I'm totally undercover. I'm not dressed like a giant chicken where they might be like, come on, dude, try a bit harder. But I do blend. Then they fucking start talking about showing their dicks.
It's like, look at the new guy.
Totally, yeah.
Show us your dick! And you're like, they didn't put a dick on me.
Why didn't they think of that? How long would I sit in that coop listening to the conversation? Like, I think the first time a chicken said something, I'd be like, aha! And they'd be like, oh shit.
The jig's up.
Caught.
See, I would imagine that if chickens could talk, in a world where chickens could talk, they'd be smart enough.
And we're not talking about, bleh! We're talking about...
Look at my dick!
Devil's tied up the series, 2-2. Like, they're interested in the shit we are.
I think that if you had the power to do that, one of them would have been like, stop fucking eating us! Like, in the world where chickens could talk and they love their babies and all the rest of that stuff, then why wouldn't it occur to them to be like, look, stop eating our children?
How do you know they haven't? How do you know that some chicken hasn't said that on a farm to Farmer John, and Farmer John was just like, oh my god, if the word gets out that chickens are almost human-like, I got no work.
I'd say Farmer John's first reaction would be like,
Satan is in the chicken!
He could be scared of demon possession, or he'd try to, like, make a buck off of that. I'm sure he'd make more fucking money off his talking chickens than out of his fucking eggs.
Yeah, but let's say he's got the talking chicken, and he's like, I'm going to take the talking chicken out into the world. And the chicken is around the microphone. Finally, I have a forum, a platform to address the world. Like, look, we all talk. All of us chickens talk. I'm not the only one. Farmer John can't get rich off me because all the chickens talk. Farmer John is fucked. If he had thought ahead, he'd be like, I let people know that chickens talk, if I spill the beans, my livelihood is killed.
Well, the chicken would lie. The chicken would be like, I'm the only one that talks.
Until he gets in front of a microphone?
Yeah.
Wow. That is presupposing a world in which not only can the chicken speak, but it's devious.
The chicken would be. It's sitting around the coop all day.
That's true.
I'm going to bet on the chicken. I'm going to bet on the super brain chicken that's smart enough to know that the revolution's going to start. But if he fucks it all up, he better be off being the celebrity chicken fighting for his cause and just going out there and being, hey man, we're all fucking talk, Farmer John. We're all fucking talking, mostly about our dicks.
But still, so do you. In a world where the chickens reveal themselves to be
highly intelligent,
higher brain function animals, how long before we stop eating chicken the world over? Because it's not like immediate, it's not like happy feet, like, oh shit, that penguin is dancing, let's stop fishing the ocean.
I'd say that the immediate reaction is that a lot of people would stop, and a lot of people would just start killing them out of fear.
Because if it can speak, then it can plan. If it can plan, then we're next. Well, that was a fun episode, Kelly.
Yee.
And with that, that's another week in the can of podcasting. So that's two episodes. I'm at Bonta.
And I'm Kelly Stoll.
Stay classy, Reno.